Hey friends, it's me, 8Ball, back with another Hiveswap Friendsim video, and today we will be finishing up volume 17 with Nikki Mula's bad end. The last time sorry, I just choked on my own tongue. Last time we covered Daria's bad end, and that was pretty traumatic, and I heard Nikki's is bad too. Like, crap, I forget her name. Also, I'm gonna turn down the music. Oh, fuck. I'm gonna turn down the music real quick. Do-do-do-do-do. Options. Just a little bit. Okay. Yeah, I'll put it right there. Okay. Kudos menu. Alright, so I heard that this one's bad too, but I don't know exactly how. Yeah. I'm gonna prepare myself to die. But yeah, here we go. We're going to be covering the long bad end because last time we covered the short bad end, as well, so. Dim lights and the din of a roaring crowd and the smell of horribly overpriced and nauseating concessions. Even across galaxies, timelines, and perhaps even universes, there is still something deeply familiar about a sporting arena. Smash her, mother honking face in! There is also something deeply familiar about sports fans.
Blood, such a shame having seats next to the purples. They can be so rude and crude and boorish, don't you agree? Chud wouldn't be nearly this loud. Usually.
You find yourself here, attending a wrestling show, or display of muscular theater, to use the troll terminology, thanks to the benevolence of one Amicia Erden. She won the tickets in a raffle and excitedly invited you to come along. You agreed, with some reservations that you quickly expressed. She was quite disappointed, but eventually agreed not to kidnap you and keep you locked up as a living paint jar, since you're buddies and all. What a sweet friend. You have to admit, though, muscular theater isn't really your thing. It's as over the top and ridiculous as human wrestling, which makes it perfectly entertaining enough, but it's also, well, a lot more violent. Participants aren't expected to die, as far as you can tell, but you've already seen a few get wheeled off on futuristic hover stretchers with injuries that you're not sure they could survive.
Oh gosh, she nearly got impaled there!
Every match tonight is taking place within a chain-linked cage. Spikes around it on both the outside and the inside, and jut out occasionally from places where the wires cross. The overall design, in addition to ensuring maximum bloodshed, seems to keep both wrestlers inside and the audience out. Ironically, it might be safer this way. The current combatants are some olive blood named the Huntress and a purple blood calling himself Culpitz. Interestingly to you, there is nothing clown-like about him at all. It is most conspicuous how unclowny he is, if only due to the absolutely ridiculous amount of clown content you have imbibed in the presence of other purples. The two fighters appear to be clearly evenly matched. The olive troll ducks and weaves amid blindingly fast punches from the purple, slashing at him with grandiose arm gestures. Trying to overwhelm him with a barrage of small attacks. Every one of his punches hits hard enough to knock her down, but she always springs up before he can land a second hit. She's incredibly steady on her feet and quicker than he. In fact, you get the distinct impression that the olive troll is holding back, presumably as to avoid inciting the crowd. Thus far, you have not seen a single match in which the lower blood opponent triumphed over the high-blooded foe.
I must admit, this match is a lot more tense than I was expecting, but I hope it ends soon. There's supposed to be a really famous muscular theatrist performing next. Her name is Nikki Mula, and she hasn't ever lost a fight. I heard she even beat a violet blood once.
Nikki Moolah, huh? That's a name you could befriend. She must be a big deal as Amicia makes her... What? She must be as big a deal as Amicia makes her out to be, because she uses her real name instead of some ridiculous made-up nonsense, like John Cena or Hulk Hogan.
Oh, look! He got her! He got her!
You flinch. The purple blood finally managed to grab to get his quarry in his clutches. He lifts her up by the face, digging his fingers into her skull until you hear a sickening crunch, and she collapses to the ground, panting heavily. She can't bring herself back up to her feet, and the announcer calls the match, to an uproarious applause from the audience. Two trolls enter the cage and start dragging her out, while the winner basks in the audience's affection. The olive blood looks like she'll probably live, but she's got a dent in her face that probably isn't coming out, ever. Ugh, all of a sudden you think you really need to go, get a bathroom. You mean, use the snack. You mean, you'll be right back.
Okay, come back soon. The fight has given me all sorts of ideas for a new painting.
You quickly make a break for it, jostling your way through the stands and towards the exit of the arena. But before you can make it, a voice calls out to you. Some slick-haired and slick-finned violet-blooded guy wearing a full suit with a tacky flame pattern on it. Hey, you alien! Me, you ask? Pointing to yourself nervously. No, the other alien. You swing your head around wildly, looking for another alien. It's, what? This bit plays out predictably for a while before you both get on the same page, which is that you're the alien whose attention he wants. You looking to make a little extra buck? No, not really. You never spent all that money you won with Azdja. Okay, what about fame? Frankly, you are probably already too famous for your own good. Friendship? Oh shit, yeah! Sighing with relief, the troll leads you backstage while it's explaining that he is a promoter for this wrestling ring. One of the trolls that was supposed to perform tonight was eaten by some giant plant called a troll devouring catchy gabbler. Grabber? Catchy grabber. Okay. As such, famed muscular theatrist Nikki Moolah has been left with nobody to fight. You will be that nobody, somebody. An alien will bring all sorts of media attention and controversy, which, of course, means big bucks for him, and friendship for you. Nikki is so friendly, he says, in a tone so insincere that even your friendship-addled brain refuses to believe it. It's okay, you've met worse. Ugh, look at this strong girl. He takes you into a back room, which seems to be full of performers waiting for their turn on stage. There are all sorts of trolls here, muscular and sweat-soaked, blue-blooded, more often than not. One troll in particular stands out to you, from her severe expression to her pulsating robotic leg, to the fact that she's the only troll with a fully illustrated sprite. She's currently doing bicep curls with a set of spiked weights, huffing with exertion when the promoter approaches. She looks up with a scowl. Oh, fuck, I forget her voice. I'm just gonna come up with a new one. I'm busy! He begins to explain that he has brought a new challenger for her to face, but she cuts him off and stands up. She isn't as tall as you expected, but damn if she isn't dense. Packing more brawn than any other troll you've ever met. Do you want to know what happens, sister, to people who disturb my preparations? Do you want to experience the bone-crushing, torso-shattering impact of these ladies right here? She flexes. God, those muscles are huge. The promoter tells her that she really doesn't need to keep up the act, there's no cameras back here. She gives him a stern look, which distinctly suggests that she has never dropped a kafab in her life, and has no intention of starting now. Make it quick! The promoter makes it quick. So, let me get this straight. You expect me, to perform with this thing? She seems less than impressed, which you find reasonable. Magnificent legs aside, you don't really look like the wrestling type. Don't you dare insult me, sister. I'd rather you pull the rusty from the audience than subject me to this humiliation. Oh, but, you are more than just an audience member. Frail though you may be, you have the heart and soul of a wrestler. You have long, much longer than about 5 minutes, you thoroughly assure her, waited for an opening such as this, to reveal your true passion to the world, to come alive on stage and grapple and tumble with the best of them. For eons, you've thirsted for this chance to sing the song of sinew, the hymn of heft, the melody of muscle. Would that you could be blessed by the opportunity to live the life of the athlete, to perform alongside your hero, to show the world that you, too, love to do the muscly thing. That you might just... Okay, I get it. She glances over at the promoter and then back to you. It does seem surprisingly articulate for a lesser being. But is it ready? For a butt-clenching, flesh-abrading, knuckle-blistering, muscle-rippling smackdown from uptown? Yes. You nod your head confidently. Blister my knuckles and abrade my flesh, you say. Let's get this smackdown started. You've got guts, at least. She turns to the promoter and gives him a curt nod. The match is on. Then she turns back to you. Now, sister, we need to discuss the show. I will make all the decisions. You will respond adequately to the storyline I present. It will be thus. The alien invader challenged me to an exhibition match to topple the mightyarchy. They fight valiantly and show an entertaining display of strength. But in the end, as the right and proper... The noble hue of the hemo spectrum prevails again. Aw, oh, man, she's a babe. She starts flexing and showing off for an imaginary audience before turning back to you. Any questions, sister? Yes, actually. You do have a couple of questions. First, will you die? No. Unless you are particularly disgustingly weak, in which case, maybe. Oh, it's hard to match her enthusiasm. Such is the risk we take, we who indulge in that most noble and dignified of sports. I was willing to give up my leg for the craft. Is your life such a heavy price to pay for a tale that will transcend us and be remembered in the annals? Why did I say annals? I was trying to avoid saying the word anal. An annals of muscular history? Is it, sister? Well, it's rhetorical. All right. Secondly, she says exhibition match. It is a muscular theater term, referring to a match staged for entertainment that does not affect one's ranking in the flex ladder. We will not be sparring in the nude. Oh, thank God. Such glorious displays of raw, chiseled physique are reserved for the intergalactic troll Olympics. No, yeah, you got that. Mostly you were wondering if it meant the loser's head will be exhibited on a pike, or some other bloodthirsty nonsense. Do not degenerate this noble sport with claims of savagery. Thirdly, you are getting the sense that she's going to be playing the heel, yeah? The what? You explain that, in your own cultural equivalent of muscular theater, performs generally fall into the category of face or heel, Where in the face is the rule-abiding and sympathetic figure the audience is meant to root for, whereas the heel takes a more aggressive and unlikable personality. What part of my personality is unlikable? Don't you dare suggest, sister, that the audience won't be roaring in thunderous applause and admiration as I conquer? Jesus Christ, okay. As I conquer yet another pitiful foe. You tell her, you know what? She can be both the face and the heel. He'll just be subjugated under my heel? Yes, exactly. Hey, Moolah, chatting time's over. You're up. She jerks her head back and jerks her head back at you and silently marches out of the room. You begin to follow, and the promoter directs you to your entrance on the other side of the arena. You wait nervously for your cue to enter. Well, folks, we've had some technical difficulties, but here comes the match you've all been waiting for. Wearing the belt of champions in the leg of her own design, she is ready to gut competition. Ready to gut the competition. A paragon of power, a lady of legwork, a true blue refinilator? That's okay. Refinilator in the making. Clap those hands and activate your screech crevices. It's Nikki Moolah! Nikki approaches the stage to thunderous applause, raising her arms and soaking in all the praise. Oh. She flexes and I forgot they threw fucking milk at her. She flexes and poses as the audience throws glasses of milk at her, which shatter uselessly around her steely frame. This appears to be a common ritual for her. She steps through one of the cage doors and it slams shut behind her, locking tight. With her arms crossed and her teeth firmly gritted, she awaits you. As the announcer begins a new intro speech, you step forward. And in the corner, frail in stature, weak in knees, wearing a perpetual look of befuddlement, we have some messed up low blood alien. How has this absurd mockery of life not been culled yet? Perhaps only so fate could lead them to their thrashing and bloodthirsty hands of barbed foot of the Grand Nikki. A decent portion of the crowd boos at you during your approach, which you find unsurprising. You have to dodge a hail of old boots and rotten fruit. Somebody throws an entire piano at you. Relatively unfazed, you enter the ring and hear the door close behind you. So, you come here, alien, to prove your kind superior to the unbreakable, unstoppable troll species? Yeah, you shout. Your kind is so superior to trolls. And you, their emissary, does this creature look superior to you, my theater enthusiasts? She turns to the audience, throwing a hand in gesture at you. They boo. Is this sorry specimen the best its planet can offer? More boos. You counter that you came more than prepared to tackle the, matriarchy? Yeah, that. So you claim to be prepared, but are you prepared to face these 24-inch slither noodles? She flexes so hard, the announcer's sleeves explode. So be it. I'll crush you in a single blow. You're expecting a referee to start the match, but then it occurs to you that there is no referee. Somewhere in the distance, a bullhorn sounds, which apparently is the signal to begin. Without taking her eyes off you, Nikki grabs the cage wall behind her and hoists herself up effortlessly, scaling it in reverse until she reaches the top. The announcer is screaming something about this move being called the Spiky Nikki. Once she finishes her ascension, Nikki deftly leaps from the edge of the cage and spins down towards you. Her body twists and writhes in multiple blindingly fast flips before her robotic leg comes slashing at you. You spend some time admiring her dazzling form before it occurs to you that you should probably move. You duck and roll to forwards, feeling the point of her leg just barely graze your scalp. The announcer shouts, "First blood," as you feel a light trickle down the back of your neck. Some members of the crowd are booing, presumably because they just noticed the color of your blood. Between the neon lighting and the distance, they probably just think it's a rust-colored and not a mutant red. Or so at least you have... that going for you. What you don't have going for you is time to think about your next move, because Nikki pivots on her heel and charges at you. This time she's going for a more theatric throw. Two powerful hands grab you and lift you up over her shoulder, where you nearly gore yourself on one of her horns in your struggle to escape. Oh, there he is. Right there. You plant two hands on her back and push hard. You are delighted to find that her grip loosens and you go tumbling over her back, landing with a clumsy stagger on your feet. You're not sure if she let you get away with that one for the sake of the show, or if you just slipped out of her sweat-soaked palms, but you're going to charitably assume the former. She turns to face you, grunting and baring her fangs. She charges, rearing back a fist, and then sending it barreling towards your fragile human nose. You leap out of the way, only narrowly dodging it.
All you've done is avoid me, coward! Where's your killer instinct? Do I scare you? Are you loath to face my true blue, muscle-bound beauty?
You take this as your cue to attack, and instead you run full tilt away from her. It isn't fear carrying you, you swear.
Fool! There is no running or hiding from Nikki Moolah. Stand and fight!
She sprints towards you as you flee. The crowd is on tenterhooks. Nobody knows what you're doing, least of all you. You think you can pull something cool out of this? You leap up at the cage wall, barely dodging the spikes that line it, and use the slight amount of give on the chain link wires to springboard you off. With an exuberant grin, you go flying at her, arm held out for the classic clothesline maneuver, and then you collide with her own arm and whoop! You blacked out. When you wake up, you are lying on what appears to be an exercise mat. You can feel a telltale throbbing sensation in your face that indicates a black eye. The rest of you, thankfully, doesn't feel particularly hurt. Nearby, you can hear the huff and puff of exertion. You glance over and spot Nikki training on one of those leg press machines you always saw in the gyms, but never had the courage to attempt to use. She's wearing an exercise outfit, which, despite its vastly different purpose, looks almost exactly the same as the outfit she wore to the ring. It has all the functions of a fitness would want. It's loose, it's breathable, and the artists don't have to draw a second set of sprites for it. Yes, me too. As soon as she notices you're awake, she turns to speak to you. She doesn't even stop her workout.
You're finally awake, sister. Welcome to my hive. I have spent so much time, so much precious, valuable time waiting for you to open your eyes.
Oh God, how long have you been out?
About 40 minutes.
Oh, that's not so bad, is it?
Perhaps, but only when compared to your abysmal performance in the ring. To be knocked out cold by your own attack,
Wretched! Am I impossible? I am an impossible foe to conquer, and yet even a Rusty has towed me longer in the realm of mortal combat. You are weak, sister! Offensively so! She slams her foot forward with such velocity the weight on the leg press goes flying off and leaves a dent in the floor. Grunting, she stands, takes a long swig from a bottle, and then approaches you with fire in her eyes. What do you have to say for yourself? You scuttle backwards, preferring only a sheepish smile. You're sorry, you guess? I didn't bring you here for apologies. I brought you here to see your heart ignite with the will to improve. You are not a worthless being. You have a flair of theatrics and appreciation of the sport, and a shining soul filled with only the most intractable determination. Intractable? Yeah. I just spit all over my screen on accident. Whoops. You could be so much more than you are, sister. I could make you so much more. Cast your gaze around and behold, the Bronisium! You obediently cast said gaze around. This room is massive and littered with training equipment, as far as the eye can see. Much of it resembles exercise machines like the ones you had in gyms back on Earth, but there is plenty more that looks far more alien and deadly. A treadmill, which appears to throw the runner into a vat of acid if they fall off, a series of swinging axes that would look at home in a dungeon, three varieties of Iron Maiden, which each more horrific than the last. This is presumably Nikki's personal workout studio, but you could easily mistake it for a torture chamber. You wonder if Ardata has maybe considered a job as a personal trainer. Maybe you should bring it up with her. There are some who may be worthy of my expertise, and it is here that I can forge them, just as I forged myself into beings of adamantine strength. The journey will be harsh. If you are made of weaker stuff than I believe, you will perish in agony. But if your core is strong and your will of iron, yours will be an unquenchable might. She extends a hand to you, her jaw set. Join me, sister, and together we shall ascend. To transcendent heights of muscular perfection. There's a look in her eyes that you have never seen before. One of hope, of faith. Her arm vibrates, muscles quaking. Do you take it? So I'm going to hesitate because last time I took her hand, that led to the good ending. So we are doing the bad ending. Woohoo! Let's die! You begin to offer your hand, but under her steely gaze, your resolve wavers. This all seems like a lot. Too much, even. You don't know if you're made of that stuff tough enough for the training she seems to be offering. You would like to prove yourself. To become strong, you really would, but does she perhaps just maybe have any courses a little easier on soft, squishy creatures like you? The expression on her face grows terrifyingly blank. She's not scowling, or snarling, or sickened, or any other S-word. She's just looking at you, with the vaguest hint of disappointing dripping from her otherwise neutral expression. I see. So you're like the rest. So you're like all the rest, aren't you? Unworthy to receive my gifts. Unwilling to reach your full potential. A pathetic, simpering thing playing at dreams of muscular greatness it can never achieve because it doesn't have the will for it. You're an insult to my art. You spit on my passion. Get the fuck out of my face and do not ever dare to return. Shrinking under her steely gaze, you quickly flee her hive. is this it for you? Is the screen going to fade to black and replaced by some goofy and replaced by some goofy cartoonish end card and some somber game over music composed by artist genius James Roach? Yeah, he's a fucking artist genius. No, you refuse. You are not ready to call this friendship kaput. I'll show her and her draconian methods up. Damn it. It's time to get ripped! You're going to do it your own way, and then return, and she will be so utterly impressed by your muscular growth that she will have no choice but to admit that you are friend material. Sadly, you do not know any other blue bloods characterized by an absurd love of muscles and bodybuilding. They're basically all total nerds, actually, but you can perhaps think of someone from a nearby hue who can help you. Ah, yay! Fuck, I forget her voice. The door swings open with gusto, and you are greeted by a familiar smiling face. Fuck. Do I come up with a new one? I don't really want to. Okay, hold on, I'll be right back. Okay, I think I got it. Think. Keyword. Okay, let's try.
Oh, what an unexpected surprise. You really should have called, or texted, or did literally anything else to alert me, to the fact that you wanted to visit me on such short notice when my schedule is so terribly packed. But that's alright, I can squeeze a meeting in, I'm sure. Do come in.
Oh, Tysius, good. Goody. You step past the threshold of the door and into her office / living room. Tysius is sprawled out across the couch lazily, holding up a book to her face. It looks like she's studying, which is a relief to you because you would have felt terrible if you had interrupted some intimate time between them. Unless studying is intimate time, you kind of hope studying isn't intimate for anyone. The prospect terrifies.
Would you like to join me and ZZ for some grub loaf, or if it's no imposition, I promise.
You absolutely would. You didn't know Stelsa was a cook on top of everything else she does. Sorry, I just fucking punched my mic on accident.
Oh no, I never could. There simply isn't enough time. Just ordering some door smash. It's excellent stuff, really. It is easy. Has some very colorful words for the taste.
What? It's pretty bitchin'.
Yes, it certainly is. That pencil, your good friend here. Pencil, your good friend here, and for a dinner date, can you, darling?
Okay. They're literally right here anyways. They're literally right here already. We don't need to do that. Stelsa pauses and blinks as if processing a foreign concept.
Right!
Sometimes Stels forgets that you don't have to put everything on a schedule. Which is fair. School feeding changes a troll. Stelsa pulls up a chair and gestures for you to sit down at the front of her desk.
All that said, while we wait for the meal to arrive, let's get down to brass tacks. What brings you to my lovely abode tonight?
Maybe they just want to see you. People don't always need a reason beyond that. You actually do have a reason, though. Shit. You explain to Stelsa that you have a friend, more accurately a friend-to-be, or perhaps acquaintance. Or perhaps a person of chum-adescent quality, who you would like to impress, although impressed through the pursuit of personal fitness. You recall that Stelsa was jogging when you met her, so maybe she could help you put together a fitness routine, and you could do some workouts together. Her expression lights up, and she clasps her hands together.
Oh goodness, I would absolutely love that! My poor Zizi is usually far too tired and far too busy. Sometimes I don't know how to manage it myself. So I'd absolutely love a partner to keep training Steziette running on me. To keep train Steziette, okay. Assuming, of course, you won't be late yourself and can keep up with my pace.
Fair warning, it's blistering.
Isn't it enough? Thanks. Isn't it though? Thanks, sweetums.
You confidently assert that, if nothing else, you can keep pace with her. Your legs have seen a lot of use, walking, running, fleeing, prostrating yourself before clowns. You know, the usual.
Excellent! We'll set up a time. We'll set up some meetings, then I'll add you to my schedule. My people will call your people, etc., etc. Thanks for visiting. It's been ever so lovely to see you. Toodaloo!
She's halfway through shoving you out the door when you remind her that she invited you in for grub loaf. She hastily and apologetically pulls you back inside. Tizzy is snickering in the background. Don't know what I'd do if I didn't have stealths. Someone has to be the energetic one in this quadrant. The contrast is certainly a stark one. Has Tizius considered quaffing energy drinks here and there? Perhaps they would help her keep her pep up. One, I'd probably literally die. Two, you don't want to see me on energy drinks. Nobody does. Fair. You spend a while longer chatting with Tizius before the delivery arrives and the three of you have dinner together. The grub loaf is exactly as bitchin' as advertised. Though a wonderful meal with wonderful friends, the perfect precursor to the fitness montage yet to come. You visit Stelsa multiple days in a week, fitting yourself to her incredibly convoluted and packed schedule. The feat doesn't actually prove very hard, you basically only exist to spend time with friends. Her equipment is delightfully free of torture devices. Besides her step machine, she also owns quite a bit of smaller exercise paraphernalia. Aerobics, doodads, and thingamajigs, yoga mats, jogging outfits, even one of those huge bouncy exercise balls, which she bans you from using after you accidentally send it careering into a carefully organized stack of books. Careening, that's what that word is. Stelsa carries herself forward with a peppy, always-on sense of gusto that can be difficult to keep up with. But her bright smile and encouraging attitude to do wonders to keep you invested and to convince you that you really can acquire the swolehood you dreamed of. By the end of the perigree, you are, well, you wouldn't exactly call yourself ripped, but your muscles are definitely toned in a way they previously were not. You feel hale and healthy, more energetic than ever, with a bit of an extra pep to your step. Apparently, regular exercising makes you feel good? Wild. As you look at yourself in the reflection of an acid puddle as you flex, you watch your muscles bulge. Fuck yeah, it's time. At least, you hope it's time. You climb into your scuttle buggy and prepare to set the autopilot to Nikki's place, but something steals your hand. Some strange sensation that has been slowly, surely settling in your stomach. A sense of unease, of dread. Your days of foolish ignorance are long past, and in their place is a burgeoning understanding of the universe in which you exist, and the harsh laws by which it rules its inhabitants. You are beginning to fear, made the wrong choice with all the consequences, such as lapse in judgment entails. Will you ever truly befriend Nikki, or are you cursed to live, for who knows how long, in a world without her sweet smile to cure your insatiable addiction? Mayhap you need not wonder. Mayhap the time has come to look inside yourself and know. You're going to give your chakras one real motherfucker of a blitzing. It's going to take mood music of the highest caliber. Having picked some meditative tips from Boldier, you navigate your scuttlebuggy's radio dial to an achromatic buzz station, which is currently playing some soothing ocean sounds. Is that what that's playing right now? I can hear it. The very gentle lap of water meeting the shore. The rhythmic beat of the tide is steady and as sweet as a mother's heartbeat. It's interspersed with distant honks and weird animal chittering, of course, because this is still fucking Alternia. You lean back in your seat, reclining as far as it can go, and sink into the cushiony softness. Something sharp is poking at your rib, but you try to ignore it. What? You close your eyes and allow the white noise to flood your senses, blocking everything else out. Oh yeah, you're really vibing this shit right now. Chakra status, blitz to all hell. Dot dot dot. You imagine casualty as a river. Every choice a branch, tributaries upon tributaries, winding ever downward, pooling in lakes of inevitability. The pit in your stomach gnaws. It all ends here, stagnant, bitter, water reeking of death. The ocean ever out of your reach, your soul ever yearning for the single solitary and estuary among the ceaseless spillways. You take a deep breath, water laps at your sides and tickles your ears. You are adrift. You feel a gentle bob as you float down the river, hear the rush of a ticking clock. Gravity is time pulling you ever forward. Which river is this? To what end does it deliver you? Your breathing slows, then shudders. You feel the rapids approach, the rivers blur, then shift your heart rewinds, missing a beat, a surge of... Then shift. What? Okay. A surge of emotion, water streaking down the curve of your cheek. Your lungs ache. Which lungs? Which river? Which you? You try to focus on the water. You try to focus, but the water beats at your brows. Lashes your arms and legs, too tired to swim. You try for another breath. But nothing comes. With a tumultuous gasp, you sink beneath the surface to the churning darkness below. Here, amidst the battering onslaught, images come, whirls of emotion, of sound, of thought, memories best forgotten or never known, lakes meant to remain uncharted. A crackle of thunder, rain, tearfall. Single drop of olive, the record skips. Pace through rage, the whirl of the carousel, the horses whinny as the calliope sings, the circle takes you. Searching eyes implore you, the puppet strings stretch towards the moon, the flash of a blade, the spray of blood, her strings are cut. The crackle of energy, the world gone grayscale, eyes deeper than the deepest pit, a shuddering final breath. You are lost, lungs burning, water clogging, every inch you furrow your brow, think, find your river. Coughing, wheezing, a final rattling gasp, panic seizes you, a resounding crack, the stamp of hooves, a ricochet of gunfire. The death of one of thousands. A low, sinister honk. Footfalls, loud and deep. The swinging of a club. Blood on the pavement. Dark, acrid smoke. Indistinct voices and crackling intercom. A lurch beneath you. Feet thrown out. Neon energy crackling green. Choking desperate lungs aflame. You focus your will. Where are you? Which are you? Find your river. piercing eyes, a stern, uncompromising gaze. The stench of acid, crushing spikes, the body worn to nothing, all for her approval. A puff of exertion, gray muscles flex, spirits lighten, a gulp of water, the shine of a smile. Looping tape mirrors and mirrors, not looping tape, mirrors and mirrors, the end, like time, infinite. The mind, like time, infinite. The tributary splits, and you finally drift down your chosen route. Freshwater vision as you float towards the surface. A carefree decision, scuttling legs on the thrum of an engine, cityscapes passing by. Stern anger, a fist tightly clenched, shaking, barely unrestrained, hope crushed under rigid foot. A plan poorly conceived. Desperation, madness, friendship at all costs. Navy blood pooling on the concrete. Troll. Oh god. Oh dear god. Navy blood pooling on the concrete. Troll and plan both collapsing. Cold hatred. So I haven't been reading these ones yet, so I'm gonna go back. Hold on. How dare you insult me showing your face again. Okay. So I haven't been reading the parts up here. You shrug and start the vehicle, punching in Nikki's address and leaning back into your seat as a familiar sensation of autopilot takes hold of the scuttle buggy and begins to scuttle. How dare you insult me by showing your face again. At times like these, you envy the Purple Bloods. Well, you envy them quite often, actually. They've got amazing strength, unbelievably beautiful rap gods, and honestly, Fago's starting to grow on you. But right now, you just wish you were contortionist. These vents are way too tight. See, look how strong you are. You can lift these weights with ease. You could lift something bigger. You would be happy to demonstrate if she would stop advancing on you with intent to full on Nelson your sorry ass. To full Nelson your sorry ass. Ah, my other leg. Navy blood pooling on the concrete. And plan both collapsing. Troll and plan both collapsing. Cold hatred in her eyes. You're just thankful that you managed to snatch your water bottle out of the scuttle buggy before she tore it in half. The importance of hydration is never more evident than when you spend hours fleeing in terror. How is she even doing this with only one working leg? Tense footfalls on the pavement, muscles strained to exhaustion, the sun rising over a desperate chase. Swallowing your fear, you leap across the tracks, moments before the train comes screeching past you. Just behind you, you hear a grunt, and then a scream. Louder and more agonizing than you've ever heard. Is this it? After days, is your odyssey at an end? Escape, sweet bliss, soon to shatter, blood and stone turned to steel. I can't disable her cybernetics, they're too intertwined with her biology. Get back, she's about to strike, damn it. Fruitless assistance, your clothing, your soul, stained with blood. No, no more. Your palm must have died ages ago, but you've been etching lines into the back to keep track of time. You're nearing the 1 year anniversary of, well, you're not sure what to call it, the day you irrevocably ruined your life, the day you fled to the untamed wilds. You would celebrate, but you doubt you'll have time. She can't be far. One step. One more step. One more desperate step. After the other in an endless chase. You try your best to stifle your rugged, fearful breathing, but you know it's fruitless. Nothing can hide the terrified pounding of your heart to her bionic ears, nor the heat of your blood to her infrared senses. she can find you here, drenched in fear and sweat, hidden but not well enough. Ba-dump, ba-dump. Keyboard seeking, a searing blue eye flashes in the darkness where there's no hiding. There's no more hiding. You close your eyes. The curtains fall. One final heartbeat at the end of all time. At the end of all things. You emerge from beneath the surface with a gasp, coughing up water, and oh, it's just you, sitting in the scuttle buggy, gentle white noise still playing on the radio. What the actual fuck? Ah! It's not even over yet, guys. Okay, I need to finish this. I don't know how much longer. You take a moment to catch your breath, your heart thumping against your ribcage like it wants to crawl out and beat you senseless for subjecting it to all this horseshit. Whew, okay, enough meditation for one day. You think you were just going to reach over and kind of set the autopilot to Stealth's house instead of Nikki's. Yeah. You have no idea if this will avert or merely delay some horrifying and grisly end, or another, but it's better than the alternative. And besides, you really want some more of that bitch and grubloaf. Ah! What the shit? Okay. I guess. That is, I've got like actual goosebumps right now, and I've been like kind of like shaking. I don't know if it's because I haven't drank any water in the past like 24 hours or what, but like, what the fuck? Holy shit, dude. Man, this game really knows how to mind fuck you. Oh my god. Okay, well, I think that was a good way to end this volume. Holy fuck! Alright, well, that was the end of Nikki Mula's route and the conclusion for us of volume 17. Holy shit! Okay. Well, next time I'll be seeing you for another Hiveswap Friendsim video. We will be working on the last volume for the game, volume 18. Yeah. Woo. That's coming out this Friday. Y'all, I'm gonna die. And it doesn't help that, like, the Voltron... I'm an avid fan of Voltron. If you're, like, in the Discord server or anything, you'd know that I'm an avid fan of Voltron. And, the finale for Voltron is coming out Friday, too. So you bet your ass I'm gonna be up at 3 in the morning watching that shit. And then I'm gonna be making Friendsim videos after that. So, woo, feels weekend, let's go. Cool. Well, this was the end of volume 17. I hope you guys enjoyed the video. If you did, please like, comment, and subscribe. I love hearing your opinions, and, like, if you just want to drop random information, that's cool, too. I'm always open for game suggestions. I'm actually thinking of starting playing, a fan suggestion of a game called DolberQuest, and another suggestion of Sally Face, so we're going to see how that goes. But as always, thank you so much for watching this video. If you want to play the game for yourself, there will be a link in the description where you can go to the Steam page and get it. And if you do not want to buy the game, you can always binge my videos on it. I have covered every route so far, and that playlist will be at the end of the video, so just stick around and click there. But yeah, thank you again so much for watching this video. It means a lot to me. And I will see you all in the next one. Bye! Fucking hell!